If you've been diagnosed with thyroid problems, you're probably familiar with the marker called TSH. But a lot of people don't know what it actually means for their health because their doctor hasn't done a good job of explaining it to them. In this video, I'm going to go over the three things you need to know about TSH and also why your doctor refuses to run any other markers when it comes to your thyroid gland. If you enjoy learning about natural ways you can support your chronic thyroid symptoms and your Hashimoto's, make sure you subscribe to my channel and ring the bell. That way you'll be notified when I post a video each and every Thursday. My name is Dr. Brad Bodle, and I've helped hundreds of patients lose weight and improve their energy levels by helping them better understand the root cause of their thyroid problems. One of the keys to doing this is not only running the right labs, but also understanding the markers that we're looking at. TSH is critical in interpreting these thyroid labs, but a lot of people don't do it correctly. So let's first start off by defining TSH and understanding a little bit more about where it comes from. TSH stands for thyroid stimulating hormone. And because it's the most common marker that's ran with thyroid conditions, oftentimes people think it's the actual product of the thyroid gland. They think it's representative of thyroid hormone, but that's not the case. In fact, TSH is released from the pituitary gland in the brain. So it's not a thyroid hormone at all. It's just the communication or the link between the brain and the thyroid gland. So if it's not actual thyroid hormone, you might be asking yourself, why are we checking it at all? Well, it does give us an indirect reflection of what's going on with our thyroid hormone production and the activity in the thyroid gland. This is the way that I think of the relationship between the brain and the thyroid gland and how TSH fits into that. I kind of think of the brain like the boss of a company, and the thyroid gland is kind of like the worker. The worker's job is to assemble or create product, and the boss's job is to oversee that production. So in the case of the thyroid gland, its job is to make thyroid hormone. And if it isn't making enough, the brain or the boss is going to try to stimulate or motivate the thyroid gland to make more. How is it going to do this? Well, if it really wants to motivate that worker, this boss might get a little tough and intense, and it's going to yell at the worker. So we can think of this communication between the boss and the worker like TSH. TSH is the communication between the brain and the thyroid gland. If the thyroid gland isn't making enough product, then the brain is going to yell at the thyroid gland, and it does that by increasing TSH levels in the blood. Therefore, in a normal functioning system, and you'll see here in a second that that's not always the case, we would expect that the lower thyroid hormone is, the higher TSH will be. But we also have to keep in mind that this is assuming that our brain doesn't have anything going wrong with it, and it can accurately sense those changes in thyroid hormone levels and respond appropriately. Now, if we've recently had blood labs and we're looking at the results, what are the typical ranges we can expect when it comes to TSH? On the lower end, 0.4 to 0.5 is typical, and on the higher end, we can expect to see 4.0 to 4.5. Anything outside of those ranges is indicative of some sort of thyroid dysfunction. That being said, ranges aren't everything, and disease doesn't always happen overnight, meaning we're not healthy one day and then sick the next. Therefore, it can be valuable for us to look at the trends of the TSH levels, even if they're not out of range yet. I like to use the more functional or optimal ranges of 1.5 to 3. Now, just because you're outside of that range doesn't mean that you have a thyroid problem, but it does give us some indication that things might be trending in the wrong direction, and we should at least track those numbers in association with your symptoms. My problem is that most doctors won't take action until you're actually outside of range. But I feel that if we listen to someone's symptoms and we see those negatively trending lab values, we can start to take action now and prevent a lot of long-term damage. With that being said, the third thing that you have to know about TSH is doctors will only take action in the case of hypothyroidism when your TSH is elevated. The thing is that they only understand one pattern. They only know that if the thyroid gland isn't making enough hormone, then the brain is going to yell at it. But if that doesn't happen, then no action will be taken and you may continue to suffer with symptoms. And to that you might say, well, Dr. Brad, that makes sense to me. You already explained that if the thyroid gland isn't producing enough hormone, the brain will yell at it, and we only want to do interventions when it is appropriate and necessary. And I totally agree with you. However, what we have to consider is that it's not just about TSH and its interaction with the thyroid gland. The real magic happens when we produce appropriate levels of thyroid hormone and it's transported all around the body, it arrives at the cell, and it activates that cellular metabolism. If we don't get that last step, then everything else is great, but it doesn't make the magic happen at the end. So what if our thyroid is working fine, but as we alluded to earlier in the video, our brain isn't working as well as it should be? Maybe we had a brain injury, maybe we had a stroke, maybe there's some micronutrients that are off that aren't supporting the way our brain works. In those cases, we can have global decrease in brain function, which can also result in a decrease in the amount of hormone our brain creates. One of those is TSH. That means our thyroid, our worker, could be all ready to go, has everything it needs to produce thyroid hormone, but it doesn't get the signal from the boss that it needs to actually do that. So if there's no motivation, no stimulation from the brain, the thyroid gland will actually decrease its activity. So instead of having thyroid gland dysfunction that's leading to low thyroid hormone, we actually have brain dysfunction, which causes a decrease in TSH, and therefore our gland isn't stimulated to make hormone. It all depends on where is the origin of the problem. Where do things start? If things start with the thyroid gland, then we'll see an increase in TSH to try to compensate. But if things are starting with the brain, we're going to see the opposite. This is the kind of pattern that will not be well recognized by most doctors, and in the end, it all results in the same thing: low thyroid hormone and low thyroid symptoms for you. Now, if this situation sounds familiar to you, where your TSH is kind of all over the place, but your doctor isn't willing to look further into the problem, let me know in the comments below and let me know what was the thing that got you some better information and allowed you to actually take action on some of this stuff. So to quickly review, the three things that you need to know about TSH is: one, it's a hormone from your brain, not from your thyroid gland. Two, ranges are important, but they're not everything. And three, just because your TSH isn't high doesn't mean that you don't have a problem with your thyroid physiology. So if we know that TSH isn't as simple as it being just high or low, it begs the question, why don't doctors check other markers or assess TSH in a larger picture? And unfortunately, what it comes down to is the only type of treatment that most doctors are going to use is thyroid replacement in the form of synthetic T4. And the marker that most readily responds to that is TSH. Therefore, if there's only one kind of treatment and only one expected outcome, they're going to ignore the rest of the markers, even though they could be very valuable for how you feel and how your symptoms respond. What I recommend if you're having thyroid symptoms is not only getting TSH checked, but also checking the additional markers that can give us more insight to how your physiology is working. That includes total T4, total T3, free T4, free T3, T3 uptake, reverse T3, free thyroxine index, and TPO and TG antibodies. When all those markers are assessed together, then we can make better decisions about where your thyroid physiology is breaking down and support you appropriately. So to sum it up nice and short, doctors use TSH because it's the one that responds most readily to synthetic T4 medication. But unfortunately, it doesn't always have a lot to do with how you feel. If you want to start taking control of your thyroid health, but you need a place to start, make sure you check out the link in the description box below for 109 foods to boost your thyroid and improve your energy. It's free to download and will give you a comprehensive list for the foods you should and shouldn't eat when you're dealing with thyroid conditions. If you liked today's video, don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe to the channel. It means a lot to me that you guys are watching and sharing, and I appreciate you being here. My name is Dr. Brad Bodle, and I will see you guys in the next video.